And today on the Jesus Entrepreneur Experience, we begin a series of conversations, radio conversations. We want to have some with you, but right today we have the conversations with brave, bold, and oftentimes scared entrepreneurs. And you will discover that today we have a conversation with a real ringer. And that's coming up on Radio on the Edge, the Jesus Entrepreneur Experience. It starts right now. And as promised, on the Jesus Entrepreneur Experience, the Christian Entrepreneur Network, we want to find and highlight brave, bold, and sometimes scared entrepreneurs. And as St. Paul says, you know, they'll be just about everywhere, and they'll be in all kinds of situations, just like he was. So, Tim from RINGR, you're on the air.
Well, welcome. Hey, thanks. Good to be here. I'll definitely own up to the scared. I don't know about the brave and bold, but I'll take one of those three for now.
Absolutely. You know, I oftentimes point out, Tim, that I knew St. Paul was an entrepreneur when he said, I know what it's like to live in great prosperity, and I know what it's like to live in great poverty.
That's true.
Right off the bat, I said, there's proof the man was an entrepreneur.
Absolutely. So,
Tim, I'm going to also introduce you to our people because Tim and what he has done and what he has been brave and bold about could really revolutionize not only what we are doing, but what the world is doing, because he has developed a software that makes it possible for me to talk to him beautifully without using Skype or the phone or anything else like that, except perhaps his iPhone. It's an incredible cloud-based software system that is going to revolutionize the fact that we can have great high-level conversations around the internet around the world. And so, Tim, I've promoted you really good now. So tell your story, and then we'll get into some of your success advice.
Yeah, it better work now, right? You set me up
right.
Pretty high. I spent 20 years in radio doing interviews and hosting morning shows and working in production rooms. And I was really frustrated, to say the least, with the quality of the interviews we would do. We had all sorts of great content from authors and artists and pastors and people all over the place. But it didn't sound very good because they were always on the phone from their house and wherever, calling into my radio station, wherever it was that I happened to live at the time. And the quality was always terrible. We're very familiar with how phone audio sounds, and I thought there had to be a better way. And over time, I developed an idea, not the technology yet, but an idea that what if people's phones or their computers could record them in the middle of a conversation, and we didn't record any of the transmission, which is where all the loss and all the bad audio quality comes from. What if we could record them separately and then put the two sides together and have it sound like they're in the same room at the same time, even if they're not? And it took a while for technology to be able to catch up to that idea, to where we had phones and tablets and computers that could do that over a wireless network successfully. But once we got there, I managed to form a team of guys who knew how to make stuff like that work, and we put together RINGR. It's been almost 4 years now from our first beta, and things have been growing, and people have been finding us, and it's been a really cool experience, albeit slow and long and drawn out at times. It's really
scary
been a
too.
Fun thing. Absolutely scary, sure.
Well, that is wonderful. As I oftentimes say, you know, what really entrepreneurs are good at is they see a problem, they see a situation, and they come up with an idea. And now the problem is to get the idea all the way through to income.
Right.
And there's a whole lot of steps in between the idea and income. And you're going to be one of the illustrations of that, we hope, and you can help us all on that. So, yes, Tim, RINGR. Now, promote your stuff real good right now, and then your commercial's over, and then we're going to talk about some success, all right?
Absolutely. If you want to find us, ringr.com is the website. You can get a 30-day free trial there and try it out for yourself on your computer, on your mobile device, tablet, whatever. We aren't just a one-to-one medium either. You can do conference calling up to 5 people. So if you want to have a group of people on a call, or you host a podcast with a couple of hosts and you want to bring on a guest, we provide for that as well. And you can get tutorials and all sorts of things through our website as well. And I hope you'll check it out. We're happy to help with any issues you have or questions you have to get you started as well. And that's RINGR.com.
And I'm going to tell you, if you are an entrepreneur, you'll want to record phone calls. You will want to do all kinds of things, and you'll want to speak to people. So even if you're not planning a radio program, by the way, you're going to have to do that someday. That's just the way the world's going to work. But I will walk in and say, is this for the price, such a deal, is just one of those great productivity hacks to have for all kinds of things. Just think, you can have a conference call without all of that stuff. Say, everybody get your iPhones and we'll be on, right?
That's the idea. Yeah, get rid of all the static, all the hiccup, all the delay, the pops, the robot sound effects, all that kind of stuff. While that may on occasion happen during the call, the beauty of our system is we don't record any of that. So even if you have someone's network running really slow and they drop out for a few seconds here or there, when you get the recordings back, that won't be what you'll hear. You'll hear what was actually recorded on their device minus all the network interference. And that's really what makes Ringer different than anybody else.
And you've got a record of what was said on that call.
Exactly right.
Which is very important in today's world. Well, Tim, you've gone from being kind of what we say a W-2 guy to a 1099 guy.
That's correct.
You're an entrepreneur now, and you've been pushing on it for 4.5 years. That affects family. That affects children. That affects life. Entrepreneurialism is not a job, it's a way of life, so I would really appreciate it as a Christian entrepreneur. Just some things that you've learned that you'd like to share with us.
Well, yeah, we'd have to have about a 7-hour-long program to get through all the lessons that that I've learned. And I had a publisher approach me after being on somebody else's podcast a few years ago, asking if I would write a book about being an entrepreneur and starting a startup with pretty much no clue what I was doing. And so hopefully here very soon, a book called Smart Startup, The Fine Art of Being the Dumbest Guy in the Room will be available.
Great title.
Yeah. And it's because literally I have felt like the dumbest guy in pretty much every room I've ever been in. I do not have a college degree, do not have a business background, no legal background, no tech background. I can't write a line of code. I couldn't argue anything in court. None of that. However, I had an idea.
As I say, you're a slightly overeducated disc jockey.
Maybe not even slightly overeducated, but I was in radio and I had an idea and I felt like it would transform my life and my job. And as it turns out, because of the explosion of the podcasting world, it would really impact a whole lot of other people as well. And so I've learned a whole lot along the way about what to do and what not to do. And I think a couple of things in terms of what I've learned. One of my favorite quotes, in fact, I had a piece of art commissioned and it's in my living room looking at it right now, was a quote from Henry Ford, who said, "If I'd asked people what they wanted, they would have said faster horses." And that to
great
me,
line.
Oh, brilliant. And you could take it in a number of ways. But for me, it's saying my job as a leader, as a creator, as a CEO, as a founder is not to count votes, is not to go find out what everybody else thinks I should do and then say, OK, let's do it. That's not a leader. That's just someone who's able to count. And that's a democracy. And for me, I had to say, you know what, even if I'm told this isn't going to work, or not enough people are going to be interested, or, you know, fill in the blank for the excuse that you're given by friends or family or potential investors or coworkers. If this is something I believe to be true, that then I need to try to follow that through. And maybe they're going to be right. Maybe it won't work, but maybe it will. And a quote that I use all the time that I think I came up with, I can't attribute it to anyone else, and I've said it for years, is this: I would rather fail at greatness than succeed at mediocrity. And for me, amen. I think a lot of entrepreneurs feel that way, though they don't necessarily know how to describe it. It's like, I can't not try this. I have to. And if it doesn't work, so be it. But I have to give it a shot. And for true entrepreneurs, I think that's where most of us live, in that area of, I have something, and I got to give it a shot. And so my encouragement would be, even if you feel less than qualified, even if you feel like the dumbest guy in the room, even if you feel like you got people saying this is not going to work, this is going to be a failure, you know, you're never going to make it, you got to follow that out. Don't be reckless, you know, don't put your family in harm's way, but there are people around you who, if you have a strong vision and if you have a way of presenting it to them such that they can get on board with you, that go for it. Try it. Bring a team together and see if collectively you can make something happen. And so I guess that would be my final piece of advice, is don't try to do it yourself. I was entrepreneurial for a long time, where I had all sorts of ideas that I would try to carry out on my own, and they would fail miserably, usually, sometimes right away, sometimes a couple of years down the line. But I always felt like I didn't have the money or whatever to bring other people on board with me. And so I'd try to do everything myself. And I am not equipped to do much of anything completely on my own. And with the case of RINGR, I realized very, very quickly that I didn't have the money. I didn't have the tech experience. I didn't have people who knew about patents. I didn't have people who knew about marketing. I didn't have any of those people, nor did I have the ability to do that myself. And so I had to find ways to make that happen, by bringing together a team in some creative ways that didn't involve a huge outlay of cash, in order to make something happen that wouldn't have happened otherwise.
Right now, I'm going to pause and just say, you're listening to the Jesus Entrepreneur Experience. The Jesus Entrepreneur Experience. My name is Stan Houston. My guest today is Tim from RINGR. Just call him Tim RINGR, okay?
I answer to anything. It's fine.
And this is the Christian Entrepreneur Network, TCENGlobal.org, TCENGlobal.org. That's where we hang out, and you can find out more about us and what we do and how we can help you build a business. And if you appreciate this podcast, you can even go to TCENGlobal.org/contribute, and we'd be grateful. Right, Tim?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, Tim, I'm going to tell people, you need to play this over again. The nice thing about a podcast, if it's really good, and this has been a good one, not all of them are good. I remember Carol Burnett once said, you got to have a bad show sometime.
Right.
But this is a good one, and play it again. One of the lessons I learned was the repetition rule of, if it's good, listen to it at least 3 times. In fact, I had one mentor who taught me that if I found a good message on a cassette or a tape or something like that, he says, play it 7 times. And he would insist that I do that. He said, because there's something about the way God made our minds, that Philippians 4, fill your mind with good stuff. Just fill it with good stuff. And that's one of the keys to success. Play it again, Stan. Listen again, Tim. Okay?
If you can handle my voice 7 times in a row, that'd be fine. Sure, I'm all for that.
Well, I also know that in our conversation before, you also had a little spiritual message which said, sometimes when you're in the middle of a mess, what should we do, Tim?
Well, I think the problem is, so often we feel like the middle is actually the end, right? Because we don't know the end of our book. We don't even have the luxury of seeing how many pages are left in our respective books. It's more like sitting at the movie theater going, are they seriously going to end the movie this way? because you don't know. There's not a clock on the screen that says, hey, there's still half an hour left. Don't worry. We're going to resolve this. Sometimes it ends then.
Good mental picture. Thank you.
Right. But most often, you still got some time left. And they come, they figure out a way to resolve whatever the conflict is that's gone on. And in our lives, I've noticed that too. Whether it's a roadblock we've come up against in business, somebody saying no, a deal falling through, even the complete end of a business or an idea, that doesn't mean it's the end of us. Sometimes that thing is just preparing us for the thing, right? So
well said.
It was, I don't remember how many years ago, it was one of the recent presidential elections, maybe 8 years ago, where I think somewhere between 8 and 10 of the political candidates who were all jockeying for position to get their party's nomination said that God had called them to run for president. And there were people making fun of them because, you know, well, clearly they're not hearing from God because God wouldn't ask 8 to 10 people to run for president. That's silly. There can only be one president, blah, 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 blah. And I guess my response to that is, God might not have called them to run for president so that they would win. Maybe he called them to run for president because that would set them up for something in the future. Maybe that told them something about themselves that they realized they needed to be doing something else that he was really calling them to do. Maybe it set them up for a win for president in the future. Maybe it pushed them into some sort of business or gave them speaking opportunities or just shaped their character in a way that wouldn't have happened in any other way. And as a business person, I think all of us sort of go into this thinking we are going to, quote unquote, win. And I think for most, that probably means selling your company for millions of dollars or having an IPO and getting all this stock when you go public or whatever. But
that would be nice.
Sure. And of course, I don't think anybody's going to turn that down. But that may not be what you're being called to do what you're doing for. There are way too many other possibilities out there. And so when you're in the middle of a roadblock and you're thinking, I'm never going to get to where I wanted to be, that's not the end for you. That may not even be the point of you doing what you're doing right now. And to have a perspective where we see our lives as more than just this linear, I'm here, there's my goal, I'm going to go from here to there, and when I get there, I will feel successful. That is rarely how it works, and I found it's rarely how God works in our lives, too.
You know, I've got through a lot of experiences and going through them right now again, and I still remember one little wisdom that came to me many years ago. That's when I was actually doing program directing on the mission field and up and down, and we had a lot of young interns come down. You know, they came down to be short-term mission workers. And I discovered something just once I said after a young lady had shown the difficulties she was going through, and I just all of a sudden it came out of my mouth, and I don't know where it came from, but I'd like to believe it from the Spirit. And I said, Lori, the reason you're here is probably not the reason you're here. And that's what I meant, exactly what you said.
Yeah, it's, I think, if you look back at the Bible, literally every hero of the Bible, as you might call them, had huge, giant obstacles and huge, giant personal flaws about them.
Yes.
And I think if, for example, if Joseph's goal, Joseph and the amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat Joseph, if his goal was family unity in his life, he failed miserably, right? Because his brothers threw him in a pit and sold him to a bunch of gypsies, and you know the rest. We kind of know the story there. If Noah's goal was to be popular, he failed miserably. If Moses's goal was, you know, to be rooted in one place and just keep his family together, and just, you know, sit, he failed miserably. But if you look at what those guys did, they changed not only their region, but the world and countless lives since because of what they were able to accomplish. But if their goal had been one thing, they would have seen, my life's a failure. But it's not, because that's not what God was calling them to do. And for each of us, that's the same thing. I mean, we could easily look at, I could look at countless things and say, my life's a failure because of X, Y, or Z. But yes, God's calling me to something else. He's calling me to something different. And until I'm willing to see that and accept that and live my life in such a way that I prove that to others, then I'm kind of just going to be spinning my wheels.
You thought your call was to be a radio host and a disc jockey, but God had other plans.
Right? And that was, I mean, I think I can look back at every step in life and see how that was preparing me for the next thing. And that's not to say, you know, don't be content with where you are or any of that. But there were many times in my career where I thought, man, if I get this job, I will have arrived. I will have accomplished everything I want to accomplish or whatever. And either I got it and quickly realized that that wasn't the case, or didn't get it and had to fight through some disappointment as to why. And looking back, you know, hindsight's 20/20, you can start to see how those different steps in my life have all been used to bring me to where I am right now. And I'm a firm believer, I know some wouldn't agree with this, but I think God causes some things, but he uses everything. And yes, he can, you know, move things around like a chessboard, but I think more often, because we are human and because we have choices and because we are sinful people living in a sinful world, kind of God I serve is God who uses the stupid things we do for him anyway. And the mistakes we make, yep, and the bad things that happen, and when science runs amok, he's able to take that and use it for something good. And so even when I make a mistake or I make a bad decision or something terrible happens that God didn't necessarily cause, he's still able to use it. And to me, that's a pretty cool thing.
There's your takeaway, Tim. When I was on late night radio, I had a favorite line, which I still quoted. I would say after a comment like something that Tim just said, now say that again, Tim. God causes.
Yeah. So I say God doesn't cause everything, but he uses everything. In fact, I think there's far less that he causes than most people might give him credit for. And that's, to me, not to diminish what he can do, but more to say, because he is God, he can still allow us to be free will, to love him if we want to and reject him if we want to and to do what we want to when we want to and yet make good out of it anyway. And to me, that's pretty godlike to me.
And I would oftentimes say, and just let that sit on your head for a while. There you go. Hey, Tim, thank you very, very much. We are grateful for, as we teach people on the Christian Entrepreneur Network, the Jesus Experience, Brian Tracy once said, take 20 minutes every day to learn something new, and it'll go well with you. Well, we've taken about 20 minutes, and you've learned something good, great, and new. You should play it again, and we trust it will go well with you. And again, we'd love to hear from you, radioedge77@gmail.com, radioedge77@gmail.com. We'd like you to do, now that Tim has given us this wonderful software, you know what? I can talk to you, and you'll sound just about as good as Tim. Maybe not quite as smart.
That's not too tough, though. I don't know.
See, that's right. But you can join us and be on the radio, because I guarantee you that God has given you some wisdom, he's given you some insight, and he's given you some truth. He's given you some wit. And if you can do it with a little sense of wit and humor, your wisdom, insight, and truth, and you are a Christian entrepreneur and you're following Jesus, we want you on the radio program. I'm Stan Houston, along with my guest, Tim RINGR. Just call him that. And we'll be back in touch. In fact, he doesn't know it, but he just signed up for a regular teaching position on the Entrepreneurial Network because he passed the audition. He got
no
the
idea
job.
What I was getting myself into, but that's okay.
That's right. And so, we'd love to hear from you. So, as we always say, you know, God bless us all, everyone. Until next time, bye for now.
Thank you.